So pretty regularly, I get asked about how or why I got into self-hosting. And if I'm being honest, it's actually a few different things that got me into the hobby or the lifestyle or whatever you want to call it. Part of it was just general curiosity about what self-hosting is. And once I started getting my head wrapped around that, I realized that I could do something like spin up a Plex media server or an Emby server and save myself some money by not needing to pay for third-party media services and their ever-changing terms and prices. The more I got into self-hosting, the more I realized that I could also prevent some headaches by not being part of data breaches like so many third-party services have had over the years. One of the first big ones for me and my wife, aside from the media server, was a self-hosted password manager. The premium solution we've been using for so long kept getting compromised, and they kept changing their value proposition. So I found a self-hosted solution that we've been using happily, mostly without issues, for the past couple of years now. Another thing that's been huge for me and my family has been a DNS-level ad blocker. Now, I've used both Pi-hole and AdGuard, but ended up going with AdGuard because while they both do basically the same thing, I just like the AdGuard user interface better. And with all of the bad actors out there and the malicious ads, even the FBI has suggested using an ad blocker for an additional layer of online safety. Also, being able to self-host a surveillance camera solution has been super nice for my family. And while this may not be huge for a lot of people, having a kid with special needs changes things up quite a bit. So it's nice to have a camera up and running in the backyard to keep an eye on him while he's back there playing, so that his mom and I don't have to worry about the data going off-site and potentially landing in the wrong hands. So by getting into self-hosting, I'm able to satiate my need to regularly learn something new, save some money, and reduce the risk of being part of a data breach, and I'm calling that a win all the way around. Now, that being said, not everything in my home lab is perfect. In fact, it's still far from it, and I've been meaning to set up a Proxmox backup server, remote server, to have another layer of backups for my setup. The problem is that my Synology DS923 Plus only has 4 gigs of RAM in it, and that wasn't enough to set up another PBS server to act as a backup for my backup. The bare minimum of RAM that Proxmox recommends is 2 gigs, and that's only for testing purposes. Proxmox actually suggests 4 gigs for the basic, and then another 1 gig of RAM per terabyte of storage that you're actually going to be using for your backups. Now, luckily for me, the folks at Synology reached out and asked if I was going to be making any content about Data Privacy Day this year, and if so, if there was anything that they could do to help me produce that content. Now, if you're not familiar with Data Privacy Day, it's an international event that occurs every year on January 28th. The purpose of Data Privacy Day is to raise awareness and promote privacy and data protection best practices. It's currently observed in the United States, Canada, Qatar, Nigeria, Israel, and 47 European countries. I'll have links to more information about that and everything else in the video description. Since Synology was footing the bill for this new project, I asked them to send me some more RAM to put in my DS923 Plus so that I could set up a remote Proxmox backup server and have at least a little bit of extra redundancy. So Synology sent over 2 8GB sticks of DDR4 unbuffered ECC RAM, and it arrived a couple of days later. And then finally, a couple of days later, I got around to getting it installed. Once the RAM was installed and the DS923 Plus was booted up, I spun up a Proxmox backup server virtual machine and was ready to make use of it. Then I opened a new browser tab to log in to my main backup server, but the dashboard wouldn't come up. So I logged into my VM manager on my DS1621 XS Plus and opened the virtual terminal window, only to notice issues with the VM booting up. My heart sank. I logged into the Proxmox server on the HL15 and noticed it hadn't had a successful backup in nearly a week, and my heart sank even more. My backups run every day, but an issue that I was oblivious to prevented backups from running. I was unable to SSH into the Proxmox backup server VM or get past the error messages in the virtual terminal. Remember how I said I could avoid some headaches by self-hosting? Well, some headaches get replaced by other headaches, and the cost for not paying for a third-party service is that you now get to become your own tech support and system administrator. So far, though, I've been fortunate enough to only have a couple of issues on this scale. And luckily, most of my online assets don't change all that often. So rather than spending a bunch of time trying to recover the potentially lost data and the virtual machine, I decided to just spin up a new Proxmox backup server VM on the DS1621 XS Plus. And once that was done, I added the new backup solution to my HL15 Proxmox server and got backups and configured. Once that was done, I headed over to the new remote server and jumped down to the data store tab, opened the data storage, and went over to the sync jobs tab. Then I configured my new remote server to pull backups from the Proxmox backup server once a day to make sure that I've got an additional layer of redundancy should something like this happen again. Once all of the backups were done from the HL15 to the new Proxmox backup server, I ran verification on my backups and then manually ran a file sync to duplicate the data over to the new remote server. And look, I'm sure one of these days I'll get an offsite solution set up like I really, really should, but I want to make sure that I've got a good local solution dialed in before I add an additional layer of complexity to my setup. So whatever your reason for self-hosting happens to be sure to check your systems regularly for issues so that you can get them resolved before they become real issues that are much, much harder to recover from. Also, be sure to set up notifications for your services and don't ignore them. Actually read the notifications you get from your self-hosted solutions to make sure you don't miss something like I did. Now, ultimately, I got lucky. If any of my virtual machines or LXCs had crashed or whatever, I may have been unable to recover that data. Now, I've still got the virtual machine that was unresponsive from earlier, just in case I ever decide to see if I can get back into it and see what happened. But I think it was a remote mount of a folder on a different device. But as they say, it is what it is. So I want to say thank you to Synology for sending over the RAM I needed to get the additional layer of backups set up and configured. But I also want to thank you guys for watching me go through this fiasco that probably could have been avoided had I been more diligent. So let me know in the comment section what kind of data loss stories you've got. I'd love to know that I'm not the only one who often misses the obvious stuff and nearly causes mass data losses. Also, let me know how you recovered that data, if you did, and what kinds of things you've implemented to prevent this kind of stuff from happening to you again in the future. Again, thanks to Synology for sponsoring this video, and thank you guys for hanging out with me for a few minutes today. All that said, I'll catch you in the next one.